Private Limited, Singapore. Our HODs, Dr. R. Bhaskaran sir and Dr. N. Venkatesh sir, my colleagues and participants from various institutions. To start with, chemical engineering on a traditional career path may work in oil and gas, basics or specialty chemicals and pharmaceutical industries. They may start as a research, process development, production engineer and have a job responsibility that might include scaling up processes, designing process and equipment, planning and testing method, byproduct treatment or directing facility operation. In chemical engineering, process design is a choice and sequencing of unit for desired physical and chemical transformation of materials. Process design is a design of new facilities, or it is a modification or expansion of existing facilities. The design starts at a conceptual level and ultimately ends in the form of fabrication and construction plans. Our guest will explain about various career choices for chemical engineers and importance of process design in chemical engineering and process industries. Now I will hand over this session to our guest, Mr. Yuvraj.
Hello. Hi. Hello everyone. Good morning. So yeah, so today my name is Yuvrajan. I'm a chemical engineer, and then later I have done a master's in project management, followed by a diploma degree in industrial safety, then a PG diploma in So I worked in projects for 2 years, then I moved back to process design, and for the past 15 years I am in process design. So overall I have around 17 plus years experience. So I just thought of sharing this particular subject with the upcoming engineers, which will give an eye opening that, you know, the area where we can park ourselves in the future emerging market. So today the topic is about career choices for chemical engineers, an introduction to process design. So contents-wise, today's content, generally, if there are more than 8 participants, we generally go with the safety moment. So I'll start with the safety moment. Then career choices, what are the options available as a career choices, we'll cover that. Then we'll go into the expected skills from the employee, how the employer look into. Then we'll quickly go through the introduction to process design. I'll cover something around the safety subject as well. Then finally, we'll go to the Q&A. So now, safety moment, I just thought of sharing this recent COVID situation. That's what I was thinking, like to cover this is apt for this session. So WHO have given these 3 guiding principles, C's. So crowded places, we should avoid going to the crowded places, and then try to avoid close contact. Those things can be avoided if possible. Then always try to avoid this confined space, enclosed spaces. So if we try to stay away from this, obviously we can, you know, avoid the risk of COVID situations. So now, if you see at the bottom, we have clearly, it has clearly been described by WHO, that try to avoid crowded places and be there for a limited time only. Maintain at least 1 meter distance is what this slide says. Now the recent guideline says we have to maintain around 2 meter distance. Then always keep your ventilation on to make sure you get a fresh air and recirculation. Keep your hands clean all the time. Then wear mask if required. Currently, the situation in India is we must wear mask when we go out, because they are saying even it is actually become airborne. So we have to be very clean on this. So if you are unwell, stay home and please stay safe. So career choices. So career choices, we have 3 key areas we can park ourselves. So there is first a key area is research, the research field. We can step into after we finish our degree. We can step into research field. When we successfully finish the research field, we can select teaching profession, or we can park ourselves into R&D kind of industries, where they develop a project, develop a concept, and then those things can become a future projects. So that kind of area can be selected. The second key area is manufacturing and operations. So it is again a vast field where we have plenty of options to park ourselves. In this, I will cover the below boxes later. Then the third key area is process design. When we say process design have two different level of approach. One is the integrator, the other one is the licensor. So if you take any of these industries, refinery or petrochemicals or other fields, each and every units are clearly designed and owned by licensor companies like Axens. There are a few more, Uday, a lot of companies are there. So they own that. So what they do, they will do the design and then they will pass it to the owner. Then the process designing engineering company will do the integration process. We'll go into that later. So the top row is all the areas where we can park ourselves. So individual area, when we look into that, biotechnology, when we take biotechnology, and biotechnology, we have multiple subfields like medical biotechnology, agricultural biotechnology, industrial biotechnology, environmental biotechnology, and so on and so forth. Likewise, food industry. When we take food industry, we have so many agri products, dietary supplement products, factory farming, flavor manufacturing, beverages, fruit product packing units, a lot of things are there. So then comes to the water treatment. So water treatment, you have wastewater treatment unit as well as municipal water treatment. So we can see that is also an open option. Under wastewater treatment, you know, the filtration, water softening process, distillation, disinfection, all these processes will be there. Then comes to the waste management. Waste management is another vast field. If you look into that, liquid waste, solid waste, organic waste, recyclable waste, hazardous waste, e-waste, everything is there. So these are all, again, a process units, which is going to be an emerging market in the future. Then comes to the renewable energy. Under renewable energy, we have solar, wind, tidal, hydro, geothermal, biomass, so on and so forth. So this is also one of the sector where the future engineers can start looking into it, because the future is going to be mostly going towards renewable energy. New Zealand is already working on that, and a few more countries are really keen on these renewable energies to become environmental friendly. The second one is about the refinery. So when we look into the refinery, we have CDU, VDU, BHT, FCC, SRU, ISO, NHT, all these units are there. When I say CDU, it's crude distillation unit. VDU, vacuum distillation unit. BHT, diesel hydro treating unit. FCC, fluid catalytic cracking. SRU is sulfur recovery unit. Then ISOM, isomerization unit. Then NHT, naphtha hydro treating unit. So these many units are there under refinery. So each and every unit is having its own specialization as well as its own importance. So to step into the refinery, it is again a vast field. It is another area where chemical engineers can park themselves if they get a good opportunity. Then comes to the petrochemicals. It is actually, again, a big array of products which can be manufactured as a petrochemicals. So BTX is there, benzene, toluene, xylene. This is what we call it as BTX. So this product is there, and then biogas, then polymerization, where after polymerization, you get all the plastic-related products will be part of that. So that is under petrochemicals. Then chemicals. Chemicals is another sub of petrochemicals. So this is also another vast field. So these are the key areas. If you look into the top three rows, the top three rows can be interlinked with this bottom rows as well. So any of this area is own specialization by itself. So you can select one and you can train yourself, or you can focus towards that area. But currently, the market is really not in a good shape, but it's going to go up very well in the upcoming future, at least 1 year or 2 years down the line. But these are the areas where chemical engineers can, you know, really focus on. The right side portion is, we call in the chemical industry, we call it as upstream downstream industries. We say upstream upstream industries are nothing but just oil extraction from like FPSO. We call it as floating production storage of offloading units. So this is just, you can see here at the right, where there is a ship floating. So this is, we call it as FPSO. So downstream industries, when we say it is actually, it is a refinery processes and chemical manufacturing. So you can see here, these are the way it will be located. Like this is an exact picture of a refinery where the production units are here and the storage facilities are here. So likewise it is. Then pharmaceutical industries, we can focus there also. That is another area where it is emerging and it's going to be long lasting as well. Then logistics and planning. When we say logistics and planning, that is also a core area where a lot of chemical engineers are there. In my recent chat with a few of our client, so a lot of chemical engineers are working in this logistics and planning. What they really do is they plan what are the products that they receive from the third party and what are the products that they will mix as a crude and they send it to the processing unit. So that particular key role they play, those people are the planning people as well as they do the logistics as well. So these are the areas where as a chemical engineer we can start focusing on. And the next area where I'm planning to cover is how the market and how the employer is looking from the individual employee skill set. When we look into this, generally the candidate selection criteria is based on whether the person is having sound knowledge in his basics. Then is he a good listener to communicate? So actually, if you want to be a good learner, you have to become a good listener. Then you can be able to communicate well. Third key point, we can say you should be a good decision maker. In our corporate world, they call it as you should talk confidently and you should have a good judgment. So a person who judge well in the engineering judgments, he is a good decision maker. So that way, this key role they are looking for. Then, is this a person who is really a safety conscious person? This is also a key role, especially for chemical engineers, you have to be safety conscious because you are playing a key role on designing a system which should be fully foolproof. So that kind of expectations are there with the, you know, the employer. Then the quality in work. You have to show a good quality in work and you should avoid recycle in the work as well. So they will monitor you. They will see how best you're performing. Then innovative ideas. When we say innovative ideas, already the project will be with you. Then is there any value addition you can do to the customer? Especially let's say customer is planning to invest around, let's say $20 million in a project. And as a process engineer, you have a key role to play. You can think of all the options. Is there a way that you can optimize the cost? So there are many ways to see the perspective of how the engineering happened. Is there enough buffer has been taken in the past engineering phase? All this thing can be looked over. And then in the phase of the right engineering time, like FEED stage and everywhere at that FEED stage, we can able to do this optimization by bringing value to the customers. Then willing to adapt multitasking. So this is also one of the area there they are looking for actually. So if you are doing process engineering, immediately, like, you know, company was looking for a person who can, you know, go out to the client side as a seconded person to go and support their engineering activities. So if that is kind of a demand in a job, you should be open to that. And you have to say yes for that to learn, going to the operating plant, learning there as part of your engineering company. So this is again, they are looking for a multitasking person who can do one time, he will support the process design here. Other side, he will go to the client side and he will learn and understand what operations looking for. So this is about this multitasking. Then timely completion of the task. It is very important because a lot of projects are schedule driven. People are looking for a person who works on timely completion. So there are projects which they call it as fast track projects, where you don't have a room for a single day to delay because they have to proceed with constructing the facilities and move forward, and timely they want to start it for the commissioning because they will have a shorter shutdown window. So like this, there will be challenges. So the person should have this timely completion mindset. And the final part, which I want to cover is about analysis skill and the software proficiency. So person who is really want to be skillful, he should have good analysis skill. The analysis skill, when we say into that, you have to go into the first point. If you are good in your basics, you will have a better analysis skill. So that way, you can analyze the whatever the calculations or whatever the documents which you are taking forward. Let's say you are a checker, you should have a better analysis skill to check the document properly to give good input. Software proficiency. Now, engineering companies have n number of softwares, especially process engineering have a lot of softwares. So those softwares, you will get good training from the company. Your seniors will try to guide you. Generally, few companies are sending training to the third parties, but technically, your own colleagues will try to train you, not train you, they will just guide you to how to use the software to move forward. So slowly and steadily, they will train you to the better way, and then they will start giving you a full project to see how you're performing with those softwares. So these softwares are also key equipments which we need to use for the engineering phases. Now, we'll try to cover some key points which our client used to say this. We call it as AAA. So AAA, when we say AAA, it is Assess, Analyze, Act. So anything you got stuck and you don't know how to move forward and you don't want to go and disturb any of your colleagues or seniors because they may be busy, then you should stop. Stop what you do and start thinking. It is applicable for your examination as well. So you stop, start thinking, assess yourself, what you have learned, and you try to implement it, analyze it. What are the things to be taken care of? Is there a risk there? Is there anything which I'm doing wrong? And then try to eliminate all the risk factors. Then you act. So this is a key thing which, you know, nowadays client is really imposing on us, and as well as it is a good thing to do as well. Because sometimes, you know, day in, day out, if you do the same work, you may think that, you know, I am very much proficient with this activity. I may not do a mistake, but technically that is not the case. Sometimes error happens and it may create a cat-1 risk as well, or cat-1, cat-2 risk also. So those areas we should not fall under, because it is going to give a big loss, like $1 million, if you don't act well. These are the learnings which you know, the client side, they take over in the past and then they started putting in place. And anything we do, everyday task also, we are implementing this as a process. Stop and think. Assess, analyze, and act. So it is a keyword. Try to keep it in your mind, and it is going to help you out in a different way. Then we'll try to cover about how employees performance analysis the companies are looking on. So when we look into a successful employee, he should be a self-initiator. He should initiate himself in any of that. So he should have a good learning skill, and that learning should actually keep changing. Once you learn that, you switch the subject, learn that, switch the subject, learn that. So you have to do that. So that activity, when you do, you have to make goals. So you make goals to do every, like, if you see in our corporate companies, every 3 months, they ask us to fix a goal, and then you have to achieve it. Your manager will just do a short interview with you, and they see whether you really achieved that particular objective. Then you have to be a curious person. Always be curious. Even if you learned a lot, you have to be curious, because a lot of things which are unknown. If you see the chemical engineering field, lot of areas are unknown. So you be always curious, try to learn a lot of things. Small details will be there always in the day-to-day activities which we perform. Then always, this is very important, enjoy learning. When you start learning, you should enjoy learning. That is very important, because it goes into your subconscious mind that you will make sure when you handle a particular subject, you will make sure you don't do much of errors. When I say much of error, there is a possibility of error because of your lack of focus or something, but you don't do a drastic bad mistakes actually. So if you do a good enjoy learning process, your mistakes are mostly, 90%, 95% is already taken care. Then you plan the learning. So you should plan learning, because anything you do, like previously I was working in ISBL kind of projects. Now I'm offsite specialist. So I switched the area where I'm becoming kind of an expert in my own area. So this is happened because I try to see the pros and cons in both the areas, and then I try to park myself in a place where I can keep exploring and give a lot of value to the client. So that is the area which I plan to select. That's how currently I'm working on. So always plan your learning, then be accountable. You should be accountable for what you do. Anything you do, you don't need to pinpoint to others. You should be accountable. You must take full responsibility of what you do. Then finally, this thing will be monitored by your managers. Anybody who is sitting on top of you, they are observing you, they are reading you. So you review yourself, you reflect it. Obviously, you get your own benefits. Nobody can stop it. So if you are a good performer, they will not allow you to go out. They can pay anything for keeping you into the company. So always be kind of a good learner all the time. Try to be a good observer. Try to be a good communicator. Be a good self-initiator. Always be accountable. If you did a mistake, you say, yes, it's my mistake. It is my damn mistake. I will go back and correct it. So if it is in a bad stage where you can't be able to correct it, you admit it. Yes, it's a mistake. It is calling for a rework. I will do the rework, but I'm not going to charge you. I will do for free. I will spend my own time to fix this error. So this kind of confidence we have to show to the company as well as to the client, so they will appreciate our effort, because anything you do, it will go through some review process. Even they would have missed it. So it is a kind of a group effort where somebody have missed it. But as a preparer, the ball will come back to you. So you should see how to accept it, to fix the mistake. Nobody is going to fire you for sure. If that is the situation also, it's fine, but nobody is going to fire you, because it was a multiple people's responsibility. So everybody have missed it actually. So you have to take accountability. That's a key thing which is missing nowadays with a lot of people. So that has to be a kind of a key thing which we are insisting in the company as well. So it's going to be a process of evolution, growth in the companies. Actually, it's happening now. So then, now let's go into the introduction to process design. When we say introduction to process design, engineering design stage, we have several stages in the engineering. First stage is a conceptual design. What they do? They do a conceptual design. Let's say there are two type of projects we generally handle. One is greenfield projects. One more is brownfield projects. Maybe you guys would have not heard about this kind of words, but what greenfield is a fresh new projects where you start a company, construction, everything in a fresh field. It's a greenfield. You dig first into that land, and then you start doing your construction. That's called greenfield. Brownfield is a company where already the plant is running, and we just go and do some modification for the project objective. When we say conceptual design mostly depends on the modification that is required for the particular process units to increase their profitability or to improvise their productivity. So generally the conceptual designs will be done by the owner's engineer. What they do, they just think about a concept, how to improvise this. Let's say if they want to do a heat conservation mechanism, by adding the exchanger into a particular stream of flow where there is a high temperature fluid is going up. So they will try to implement exchanger to do a heat conservation process by adding exchanger, by sending two different stream into the exchanger and recovering the heat. Let's say there is a cold fluid where it was supposed to be heated, and there is a hot fluid which is just flowing out. So they just put one at the tube side, other at the shell side, and they will just exchange the heat. By doing that, they will be saving a lot of heat energy. Right? So this way, the conceptual design will be developed. Then after the concept is developed, the engineering manager approves. that engineering manager will be part of the owner engineer. They are as part of the business group, business team. So those people will approve that. Then once it is approved, it goes into the pre-FEED design. So there they will engage engineering company to do a pre-FEED design. In that pre-FEED design, they will try to fix the heat balance, material balance, all this thing they will do in the pre-FEED stage. Let's say, let me take about offsite, my own area which I'm working. Let's say there is a tank where they want to, currently there is a line coming in third party three tanks, let's say 2 to 3 tanks with a single line coming in. And in future, if I want to have parallel transfer to 2 tanks and the third party is running one line in, one line out, and the out line is not really in operation now, then we can do a engineering concept to do a parallel transfer by seeing that the line which is going towards the third party, whether that can be used as incoming line. So that kind of concept will be developed in the conceptual stage. Then in the FEED stage, we start thinking about how this can be executed, because the line will be flooded with liquid. Is there any way that this particular activity can be performed so that both the line can be incoming line? This design we can do by doing a lot of things like, stopple times, hot tap times. So these are the time methods we can perform to do this activity. So if the line is actually having any check valve to avoid backflow, then we have to anyway drain the entire system to remove the check valve, because it will not allow the flow to happen backward. So these kind of details we will look into the pre-FEED design. Then in the FEED design, what we do, we really do the engineering. When we say FEED, FEED means front-end engineering design. So this is the phase where we try to integrate everything. So when we say integrate everything, anything which is actually having link with the units, anything which we have link with the third party, we do the design, we properly do the MTO. MTO means material takeoff, which we do during the FEED design stage. As a process engineer, we freeze the design at the FEED stage, technically. So at the FEED design stage, we generally do safety review. So we look into the safety review where there is a particular way of doing safety review with the proper guideline. They look into the overall picture and they will try to address those pictures only during the safety review, so that during FEED stage, the major safety issues will not be there in the design. Then at the FEED stage, once the engineering is completed, mostly kind of completed, we will go for pre-HAZOP. When we say hazard and operability study. So we do a HAZOP, pre-HAZOP in the FEED stage to look into all the risks which is involved in the design, which we will go in the next slide, how it is actually happening. So we do a pre-HAZOP at the FEED stage. Then detail engineering, when we look into the detail engineering mostly, process design mostly will be frozen. What process engineer's role will be in detail engineering is, we freeze each and every details of it. When we say every details of it, let's say there is a pressure relief system, if there is an equipment where there is a vendor information is awaited, if there is a control valve, there is a vendor information awaited. All these details we will start implementing into the PIDs. So because at the FEED stage, mostly the design will be frozen. In the detail engineering design, we start getting the vendor information. We will cross-check all these vendor sizings and vendor documents, as well as the control valve sizings. And then we put it in the PNID and the relevant documents to move forward. So once that is done, we call it as design stage. So once the design stage is completed, we go for HAZOP. This is the final HAZOP for the engineering phase. So this is a detailed analysis we do. Generally, pre-HAZOP, we cover the key points only. HAZOP, we go into every detail of it, including the vendor details on all the components which is involved into the system. Then after the HAZOP is completed, all the HAZOP action to be taken care into the documents as well as the PNIDs, then we go for construction. So we have to issue for construction for all the documents. Then this particular documents will go for construction. Construction, obviously, there may be here and there some supports will be there for process engineers. Like there may be a query like, you know, we can't able to find a space here. How can we route this pipe if this is the situation? Then we start looking into that. We will redo some area, re-engineer that, and then again we issue for construction. So in the detail design, let's say piping design and all, they go and do the pipe supports, strengthening support is required, they do that. All these activities will be done as part of detail engineering, then goes to the construction. After the construction is completed, the next stage is the commissioning stage. So before commissioning, they do a walk down. The entire constructor facility, they will plan for a particular scheduled time, operating company, owner, engineers, and the owner representative, they will walk along with the engineering company. If it is an EPCM company, obviously the EPCM representative will also be there as part of that walk down. They will go and accept with the punch list they call it as, with the punch list, they just walk down the site, they go and address each and every details of it, whether we have constructed as per their expectation or not. So they go into the detail, and then finally, once it is approved and signed off for the mechanical completion, then they go for commissioning. So they will go for commissioning. This is also a core area where a chemical engineer can play a role as a commissioning engineer. So commissioning, during commissioning stage, the operator and the operator's representative will always be there full time, and they will focus on entire system, how they will fill the line, how they will be starting the plant startup and all these operations related, they will focus on. For that, they do a transient hazard as well. What if the flow is happening like this, if this line is actually not opened? So this kind of detailed look through, which will be done during the transient hazard time. So after this engineering phase, I'm just trying to cover what are the process designer's responsibilities. As a process designer, you are responsible for so many things. So I've just, there are key lists, which is you can see at the display. You are the person who prepared the system schematic. What is the system? What are the details which will come into the system? It is kind of a block diagram you prepare, and that will become as a deliverable as well. So then after the system schematic is done, we go into the process flow diagram. So mostly, I think in the engineering subject, we have this process flow diagrams. Generally, the process flow diagram in companies like us, it will be included with the heat and mass balance as well. So it will have heat and mass balance as part of the process flow diagram. So it actually have more detail with the stream numbers, how the stream comes in, how the stream goes out, what are the flows, what are the temperature, what are the pressures, all the variables will be shown in this particular process flow diagram with the stream table. Then comes to the P&ID. So when we say P&ID, it's piping and instrumentation diagram. So all the piping related, like line size, line spec, and then what fluid it is actually going, the line is going with, all these details will be there as part of the P&ID. Then the instrumentation part also will be covered as part of the P&IDs. So this is the detailed drawing, which is a key deliverables as part of the process engineering. So this is driven by the below items like piping and instrument diagram will carry all these other details like hydraulic analysis. You do the hydraulic analysis for the entire system which you are doing the engineering. Whatever the outcome from the hydraulics, they'll be reflected as a line size, as a material selected, everything will be part of this hydraulic analysis. So hydraulic analysis is also a key area where process engineers play a role. Nowadays, we have a lot of softwares in the market, like AFT, Fathom, a lot of tools are available, which is a good tool nowadays. Engineering companies have started using. Then equipment sizing, which is also part of a process engineer's role. You do the full equipment sizing, then you pass the information to mechanical group, and they take it up with the vendor, and they will come up with their own sizing, because our engineering is based on process engineering understanding. Vendor will come up with their own sizing. Whether it is acceptable or not will be taken care by process engineering. So all this thing will be part of us. Then line list, time list. This is also part of process engineers. So when I say line list, time list, it is actually an extract from the PNID. So any lines which is there in the PNID will be prepared as a list with all the details, operating conditions, design conditions, hydro test pressures. Hydro test pressures will be entered by piping group. So likewise, all the details, like what is the line thickness, everything will be there in that line list. Then comes to the tie-in list. If it is a new greenfield plant, you may not have tie-in list, but you may have the integrated point tie-in list where you just integrate it. If it is an existing plant, it's a brownfield project, you will have n number of tie-ins in the project. So those things will be listed under tie-in list. You have, there are several type of tie-ins. When I say tie-in, there is an existing pipe where you are going to take a new pipe. How to take the takeoff? If the line is live, you can't be able to just go and cut the pipe. So there are methods to do that tie-in, like hot tap, stopple, tie-ins, a lot of things are there. If they can down the line, you can go with a cut and weld method. If it is actually a bolt-up connection, you can go flange to flange bolt-up connections, so on and so forth. There are so many tie-in methods. So then this is also part of our process deliverable. Then comes to the process data sheet. Just now we saw the equipment sizing, PNID. When we do that, obviously the process data sheet also comes from our side. So we start preparing the equipment data sheets, instrument data sheets for entire system. Then after we finish that, then we start focusing on the utility consumption summary. What are the utilities involved into the system? And we will try to cover all the utilities which is relevant to the system, and we put the conceptions of that. So that is also part of engineering process engineers. Then we prepare a hazardous area process summary. When we say hazardous area process summary, we capture all the fluids which we are handling into the system as a list with its flash point and its own properties. Those informations will come from MSDS of the individual fluids. So we prepare that. So once this area classification is prepared, this will go to electrical department. So they will try to prepare a diagram in a plot plan, how this hazardous area is actually covered and captured in their layout. Because accordingly, they have to select the cabinets and everything based on the area classification. So that is one of the key deliverables. Then as a process engineer, we have to participate in pre-HAZOP and HAZOP, because generally FEED and detail engineering will be part of engineering company. Pre-FEED mostly a 50-50 chance, like sometimes owner engineer itself they do, and the safety review will be done by themselves. They will not involve the engineering company mostly. That's the reason why I have not put that safety review in this list. So our key role will be, if FEED and detail engineering is done by the same company, we will participate in pre-HAZOP as well as HAZOP. Then after we finish everything, we finish the entire IFC, we start preparing the control narratives for the entire system. What are the controls, how this is doing, what are the things going forward, if there is a forward flow control valve, what action it is doing, set pressures of the set point of that, if there is a pressure control valve, set pressure of that, PSV, what the PSV is doing, all this detail we start putting into that. Finally, the operating manual support. Mostly operating manual will be prepared by the owner's engineer. He is also a chemical engineer. They put a lot of details into that. They will ask support from our side, like, because since we have done the entire engineering, they will ask a lot of support on that. So we should start supporting or updating the operating manual for them. So these are the key activities generally process engineers do. And just I want to try to cover this pre-HAZOP and HAZOP. How really, I just want to give the essence of it, how it is. So when we go into the HAZOP, this is how the system safety, a systematic process, we just do a hazard identification. And then we go into a risk assessment of that, and we analyze the risk, how to, what kind of risk is there, how to do the control measures. Those things will be identified. Then that risk control method, once we list it out, we start implementing that into the engineering. Then after we implement it, we go back to the HAZOP chair, and we go back and then follow through and review, and then we get approved. then we go for the IFC cycle. I'll just play this one video, which you may not hear the sound, but we can see it is actually a clear version of what it is actually talking. So you can read through. I will just play through. Six steps. So Azov is originated in UK 1960s. What is risk? So two components are there. Yes, generally Hazov will be done by a group of people. All the experts will be there as part of the group. Facilitator is a Azov chair. He's the Azov chairman who run the show using the group members. Step one, identify the risk by asking what can cause a hazard receiving. So this will be mainly focusing on a specific process deviations. Yeah, this is interesting. High temperature, high pressure, low level, misdirected flow, and low or low flow. These are the deviations, process deviations. We'll see an example. What can cause high pressure in the collar? So we have emulsion coming in, we have a level controller and pressure controller here. We have a PSV set to 3400. So this is an event. So let's say the pressure control valve is closed. So let's say there is no protection here for the system. What happens to this? Can it kill someone? Cat 1, cat 2, cat 3 risk. This is the probability of the cause without a safeguard. So this is step three. There are many probabilities, like control valve, signal may not work, a lot of things. Evaluate the risk based on the severity and probability without any safeguards. So risk matrix is a detailed version. We will cover that later. So medium risk, high risk, low risk, medium. So when we analyze it, the pressure relief valve is already there, which really reduces the likelihood of vessel rupture. So the system is designed well. So just now we saw this video. So it has given a simple example, like if there was a column and there was a control valve. What if the control valve failed close due to some reason, like if the instrument signal not work well, or if the instrument tab failed, a lot of things are there. So if that happens, what happens to the column? Is this column is going to get ruptured, or is there any proper protection system is available? So in this PNID, when we look into the simplified PNID, there was a PSV set at 35 bar, 3,400 or 3,500 kPa. So that is protecting this column. So obviously, the safety risk is actually eliminated. From higher risk to the medium risk, it is moved. Technically, we take a credit of the PSVs and we put it under even low risk as well. So currently, this covers how the process safety works and how the details, they go into that. The next video I was thinking to share, which is an interesting video, but the voiceover is very important. This was a safety incident happened in ExxonMobil refinery in Torrance. So I was just thinking to share, it's around 8 minutes video. I will just share the link later. You guys can play and watch this incident. What is the root cause that can be, if time permits, I'll just play around. You can see the video, and then it's around 7 minutes video actually. So you just watch the video, maybe without voice.
Important part of the final process takes place in the facility's conformity.
This is FCC unit. So this is the catalyst falling into the hydrocarbon stream where the fluid will get cracked. These are the lighted hydrocarbons going to the column. This is the distillation column. These are the catalysts falling into the reactor. So this is the regenerator. Generally in the regeneration, coke formation happens. So coke and the catalyst will burn on when the air is added. So then they will add back the catalyst. It is called regeneration process where the catalyst will be reused. So when this happens, there will be flue gas formation, goes back to the regenerator. So these are the removal. So this is the process where all the catalysts will be removed. This is called electrostatic precipitator. It creates spark, so electrostatic precipitator just to separate out the catalyst. Is an expander unit where there is a vibration is there. So the vibration sensor have sensed it and it put it under standby mode in this incident. It's in the SIPAP mode now. Yeah, so based on that, hydrocarbon is stopped. Hydrocarbon feeding is stopped. That is also closed. So right. Steam is forced into the reactor to ensure from the distillation column the flow should not come back. So they feed the steam into that. Here the problem is one of the slide valve was passing. So continuously the catalyst was flowing through that gate valve. Within 7 minutes, everything fall into the regenerator pack. So generally the catalyst inside the section was acting as a barrier, but all the barrier is out now. So they injected a lot of steam into this to ensure there is no hydrocarbon coming back. They tried to restart it. So they thought of a strategy to how to restart it. So because the catalyst got accumulated, it can't be able to restart it. So this is the problem they faced. So they did a meeting. So they have been back to an old incident, 2012 it happened, and they have gone with a variance for the safety. They tried to use it for 2015 incident. So part of this process, they plan to install a blind at the outlet of the flange. So they tried to install a blind, but when they opened it, a lot of steam was coming out because it was actually steam filled already. So since they opened it, a lot of steam was coming out here because the barrier is broken into regions. So it is. So since the steam was coming out there, so they stopped the steam. Now what happened? Since the steam is stopped, the hydrocarbon started falling back. But they were really not aware that this barrier is out. So the light hydrocarbon started coming. Yeah, it is coming backward. And it started increasing the pressure. And the light ends are coming back into this reactor and then coming back into the regenerator. So this picture is showing that. So yeah, so all the light ends are backflowing and coming back into the reactor, filling back into the regenerator. Then the supervisor seeing there is a warning sign. More the leakage. So the HCC unit was evacuated after the alarm sounded. Again, they started the steam injection, but it was too late because regenerator is already filled with the light ends, and then it started going back into the ESP. This is the ignition sources. Yeah, so since the hydrocarbon went into that, there was a violent explosion happened. So here in this video, what we see is they have not followed a proper safety procedure. They tried to use an old variance, which was done during 2012 for some other maintenance issue, but they tried to use it for the next troubleshooting where they missed to see the regenerator, that particular catalyst filled layer in the reactor is gone, because they never noticed that the valve was passing. But that valve was actually installed 6 years before that incident. So technically, as a process designer, there are many layers which this could have been avoided. Number one, as a part of process design, we can always design this particular valve as a tight shut-off valve. So it is a costlier type of valve, but still, we can preferably, because that is a one valve which is going to hold the entire layer of a catalyst which is staying inside the reactor. So we should, as a process designer, we should always design this particular valve as a TSO valve, tight shut-off valve. This would have avoided, because of the valve passing, this major incident happened. And then a lot of other wrong way of taking a decision which created this major incident. Luckily, they have evacuated this FCC unit. So it was actually, I heard like, you know, there are some people got injured, but there was no fatality, but a lot of millions of dollars they lost because of this incident. So it happens regularly. There is one more video, which is an isomerization unit incident, where there are around 16 people, I think, they got killed in that incident. Among that, 7 of them are our own company members in the US. So it happened in the past again. It is called a BP Texas City incident. So if you guys have interest on watching this video, you can always go into that CSB website and start watching these videos to see what is the importance of process engineering. So when you step into the design field, you come to know really, you know, whether this kind of situation creates a safety incident. Obviously, yes. So there are multiple incidents there inside that website, which is you can share to anybody actually, because it's a public video anybody can watch. And it is a good learning exercise you can always, you know, share. Generally, we do in our engineering design meetings, we share any of these videos on a regular basis in our safety moments. So that ends my presentation. Mostly process design means safety is imperative, quality in work, and your confidence as well as your engineering judgments. So all this comes by your experience. As a starter, you should show a lot of interest on learning. Learn, learn, and learn. As you learn more, you can become a good engineer. And you know, nobody can move you out from the area where you are becoming expert. So anything happens to that particular sector of challenges, they will come to you only because you would have already mastered that particular engineering knowledge. So always be focused and learn and learn and learn. That ends my presentation. If you have any question and answer, you know, we can talk through.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Yeah, so the first question is from the participant Murugappan, and his question is, what are the major issues in process design?
Major issues in process design. Understanding the process, what unit you are handling, what is the role that you are playing, what is the objective given to you, that is the key thing, first of all, understanding the system. Okay, so first thing, you should understand the system and understand the objective of client, what they are expecting, what is this project about, why this project first. So all this thought process has to put in place first. Then you put your engineering thoughts that what are the things you can do, because already you will be provided with the project and you are going to engineer it. When you engineer it, you should look into the safety perspective of it and then design perspective of it. You will have your own guidelines, which will be developed by your own company. And client also will have their own standards. Like if you see ExxonMobil, we have global practices, design practices, instructions, global instructions are there. So all these things we have to learn and apply in that particular area. So your all these challenges, process engineering challenges or flaw in the design can be eliminated. Anything you raise question to client, they are there to help us out to do the project successful, and always apply your knowledge. That is key. So follow the procedures, apply your knowledge, ask questions.
So the next question is from the participant Shruti, and her question is, like, just like the other softwares, MATLAB, Aspen, HiSys, is R programming language important for a chemical engineer to get into the design aspect?
Actually speaking, like whatever we are learning in the engineering time, right, those things are just basics. We are just touching base, all this programming language, everything. But when you come to the corporate level, you are not going to see those programs at all. So mostly the companies will have their own software tools, like Excel-based tools or their own developer tools. There are third parties where, like PipeNet, AFT, HiSys, Aspen HiSys, even the FlareNet is coming from them. So including the HTRI, all these companies have their own softwares. So we will get trained and we will try to master it to a particular extent. And then, so mostly this programming language, just for basic knowledge, we are learning. But when you step into the corporate world, you will start learning all these softwares. So that's the answer.
Sir, and the next question is from the participant Niranjan, and his question is that, what are the effective softwares available in the field of process design?
Yeah, just now I mentioned about the softwares, like let's say for the hydraulics, in our company, we are using a PipeNet tool as well as AFT tool, AFT Fathom for liquid hydraulics, AFT Aero for gaseous state hydraulics, AFT Impulse is there. That is for the surge analysis, which is a key area where now it is emerging things happening, where currently I am being expert in my own core in that. So these are the softwares we use, AFT Fathom, AFT Impulse, AFT Aero, then PipeNet tools, all these things for the hydraulics. For the exchanger sizing, we do HTRI. For the entire plant design, for the heat and material balance, we use HiSys. These are the tools actually we normally use it.
Sir, and the final question is from the participant in Vishal, and his question is that, How effective doing process design course advanced is useful?
I missed your question. Can you please repeat it? I can't able to hear you.
How effective doing process design course advanced is useful?
Process design course, right?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. So we have a lot of international standards like PIP, all the API codes, especially when you are working for a particular client like Shell or ExxonMobil or BP, they have developed, even Saudi Aramco, they have developed their own engineering standards. So when we say engineering standards, we have engineering practices, global practices, Shell means DEP, those things will be used for, you have to strictly follow to implement in your project. If you have a question where you want to take some deviation, you should always flag to the client that this is the one which I see that, we don't need to implement. Can you give me an idea on this? We can always flag it to them. So they will take it up to their safety group and see whether this can be eliminated. But as an engineering company, we should follow the standards which is dictated by international codes, then followed by the local codes. When I say local codes, it includes a local standard of that particular country as well as that company standard as well. So this is how we have, there are 6 to 7 categories where you, when once you step into that, you learn it actually. So I just want to give only the overview. So international codes you have to follow, and then the company standards you have to follow, and the local standards you have to follow. That's my answer.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for patiently answering all the questions.
No problem. You're welcome.
Okay. Thank you for your valuable time, Mr. Yuvarajan. I want to conclude this session with a vote of thanks. I would like to express our sincere thanks to Mr. Yuvarajan for sharing his valuable knowledge in this webinar. I would also like to thank our beloved HODs for their moral support and guidance. I am very happy to express my vote of thanks to our staff members and participants who have made this webinar a great success. Thank you. Thank you all.